Your heartfelt prayers and encouragement have made our lives richer and our campaign stronger. Over the last few months, this campaign has been wild. We have been on a roller coaster as frontrunners seem to come and go. One of the things I enjoy most as we campaign across this country is the chance to meet so many wonderful people, to learn about their lives, concerns, and hopes for the future. As I listen and learn, it's evident that most Americans are still optimistic about the future of this country. It's been encouraging to meet so many people who genuinely believe in the greatness of our country and work tirelessly every day to pursue the American dream. Newt and I have engaged in this race because we believe America is at a crossroads and care deeply about the future of our country. Our only opponent is Barack Obama, and we are committed to removing him from the White House. Newt is the only candidate with the experience and knowledge necessary to rebuild the America we love. He has a successful national record of creating jobs, balancing the budget, and reforming government. Today, we need a leader who can clearly articulate why President Obama and his policies are wrong for America. We need a leader who understands that we must contain and defeat our enemies. And we need a leader with bold solutions to create a better future for all Americans. I believe that leader is my husband. Please welcome former Speaker of the House and the next President of the United States, Newt Gingrich.
your primary until much later, is I want to make a clear statement about a Gingrich candidacy. I am running for president to be president of all the people, to reach out, to run a campaign while I seek the Republican nomination. I want to run an American campaign. Reach every American, to give every American the choice of which future they want. And you cannot follow the recent Republican practice of writing off our largest state and imagine that you're going to run an American. You have my commitment that if you help me in your primary, and I do believe that the nominee process in Texas, which is going to come at the end of May, and California, which is going to come at the end of June, are going to be vital, and I think they guarantee, coming that late for the two largest states in the country, that there will not be any lockdown before we get to California. This will still be a very important campaign. I want you to know that, as the nominee, I will campaign consistently in California, and I think there are five basic themes that will enable us to appeal to a vast majority of Californians. The first, I'm going to spend a good bit of time on this today, is a choice. It's simple. There's always the question of choices, because in the end it always comes down to choices. If you would like to have national energy and American energy policy, never again bow to a Saudi king, and pay $2.50 a gallon, Newt Gingrich will be your candidate. If you want $10 a gallon gasoline, an anti-energy secretary, and in weakness requiring us to depend on foreigners for our energy, Barack Obama should be your candidate. If you think creating jobs and having paychecks is a good future, Newt Gingrich ought to be your candidate. If you think food stamps and dependency are adequate, Barack Obama ought to be your candidate. If you believe that America was created based on religious liberty and that no government can come between us and God, Newt Gingrich ought to be your candidate. Obama should be your candidate. Is that big? You believe in the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, and the Federalist Papers, Newt Gingrich ought to be your candidate. If you believe in solidarity, radicalism is what ought to replace all that, Barack Obama ought to be your candidate. Finally, you believe the world is dangerous and America should be strong, then Newt Gingrich is your candidate. If you think the United States is inevitably weak and guilty, and we should run around the world apologizing and appeasing, then Barack Obama is your candidate. Let me say, I for one find it very offensive for the President of the United States, the Commander-in-Chief, faced with a situation in which an Afghan soldier kills two Americans and wounds four others. Faced with another situation in the last 24 hours with two more Americans. I find it very offensive as Commander-in-Chief that he is apologizing to the Afghans when, in fact, he should be demanding an apology from the Karzai. Policy in the Middle East, one of the pillars of that policy has to be an American energy program that makes us independent of Saudi Arabia, independent of Iran and Iraq, independent of Venezuela, and producing enough oil not only for the United States, but to ensure that should the Straits of Hormuz be closed, we frankly wouldn't care.
No.
I'm not a newcomer to the energy issue. In 2008, we launched Drill Here, Drill Now, Pay Less. With Sean Hannity's help, we had 1,600,000 signers. The House Republicans picked up the theme. Ultimately, Governor Palin picked up the theme. And the fact is that prior to the collapse of Wall Street, John McCain was ahead by 3, and the Republicans in the House were ahead by 5, because the left had no answer on the issue of energy. We wrote a book called Drill Here, Drill Now, Pay Less, and Chris and I made a documentary called We Have the Power. And the purpose was really simple. We have the power. We have more than enough energy in the United States that we do not have to rely on the foreign countries. But we have an anti-American energy government, an anti-American energy bureaucracy, anti-American energy regulations. And now, we have a president who has decided to engage us on this issue. After I came out for a program to get to $2.50 a gallon of gasoline, Obama decided he had to make a speech on energy. I really hope every American will read his speech in Miami. It is a very revealing speech. It is factually false, intellectually incoherent, deeply conflicted on policy, and in some places, just strange. But imagine the challenge for Obama. Obama is a genuine left winger. That's his work. He believes this stuff. What's really dangerous about him isn't what he doesn't know, it's what he knows that isn't true. He believes in small cars. He believes in anti-American energy policy. He believes in high prices. He believes in government control. Now his challenge is he's running for re-election. The American people actually want the car and truck that they like. The American people are pro-American energy by about 79 to 16. The American people like low prices. The American people believe individual citizens should decide what car they want to buy. So Obama makes this energy speech, which you have to see in context. And I think this is what makes it so hopeless for him to go around and pretend that he's for American energy. In 2007, as a senator, Obama was the only sponsor of a bill which would have eliminated an inventory of offshore oil assets. Now, why don't you think of this? This is part of the left's great problem today. They really believe in peak energy. They really believe that, you know, we're going to run out, we have to ration, the government has to be in charge. Jimmy Carter was right, we ought to have gasoline rationing. We ought to do something in some way to make sure we don't use this oil. And their problem is that it's wrong. Now, their fear is, if they actually show us how much energy we have, we'll actually want the energy. So they want us to not see the energy, because then we can't ask for it because we don't have it. And so he literally introduced a bill that was a bill in favor of ignorance. And he went, and it's fascinating, because what North Dakota has done is it has blown apart their worldview. In North Dakota, the Bakken Formation today has 25 times as much oil. That's 2,500% more oil than they left. The Bakken Formation is now left to 3.5% unemployment in North Dakota, and that overstates the case because there are 16,000 unfilled jobs in the oil fields, and the people who are unemployed don't have the skills to put the jobs. If the people have the skills, they'd be basically about zero unemployment. And they've generated so much revenue for the state government that they've had 7 straight tax cuts, and they have a multi-billion dollar rainy day fund. Now, all of this just drives the left crazy. And by the way, there's one reason this was developed. It was on private land, and the Obama administration couldn't stop it. Now, I have to understand the framework within which these folks think. Even in North Dakota, and I believe, by the way, the Judiciary Committee should look into this, should subpoena documents, and should hold hearings. Even though it was on private land, they still decided to harass the village. So the U.S. attorney, Obama's U.S. attorney from North Dakota, filed a lawsuit against the oil companies based on 8 migratory birds. Now, wind kills about 33,000 birds a year. So if you have wind turbines, they're substantially more dangerous for birds. The wind is green, so it's good, so therefore it didn't really kill the birds. Because if it killed the birds, it would be bad, but it can't be bad because it's good. On the other hand, oil, they managed to find 8 birds. And they filed a lawsuit. The judge threw it out, so it was an egregious abuse of prosecutorial power. And I think the House Judiciary Committee should, first of all, find out the decision documents in North Dakota, and then find out the decision documents in the Justice Department that allowed such an egregious abuse of power. So they really hate the idea that this is all working. But now, remember, this is a long history. I'm going to read several things. Those of you who know me well know I usually just speak off the cuff. But I want to share stuff with you that I think is really important. Here in San Francisco, January 2008, during the campaign, this is an example of their attitude about the price of energy. Quote, I'm quoting Barack Obama, talking to the San Francisco Chronicle editorial board. Under my plan of cap and trade, electricity prices will necessarily skyrocket. And power plants, natural gas, you name it. Whatever the industry was, they would have to retrofit their operations, and that will cost money, and they will pass that on to consumers. So if someone wants to build a coal-fired power plant, it's just that it will bankrupt them, because they're not going to be charged a huge sum for all that greenhouse gas that is being emitted. So he's pretty open. Higher prices are good. They're necessary. Companies will be bankrupt. This is the true left. They also come up with silly solutions. Now, I'm going to get to algae later on. And by the way, I'm pro-research in algae. I mean, I'm a very big pro-science guy. I think algae, and I know a guy at Texas A&M who's working on algae. And I think someday down the road, algae may well be useful, that asset. But it's a little bit like cylindro. President, he's finding these things which would work someday if only they work, but they don't work, but they should work, and if only they work, you really feel much better about them working. And he doesn't want the things that do work because those things make him feel bad. So we can't do the things that do work because we want to do the things that don't work. During the last phase of high gas costs, when I was advocating drill here and drill now, here's what he was advocating. Quote, this is July 30th, 2008. Quote, there are things you can do individually to save energy. Making sure your tires are properly filled. Simple thing. But we could save all the oil that they're talking about getting off drilling if everybody was just inflating their tires and getting regular tunes. You'd actually save just as much. Now, do you know how weird your worldview is to believe that inflating your tires equals drilling? I mean, it's a little scary of a president's face, this out of touch with reality. But let me go on. I recently got in a little bit of trouble with both owners. Because I made the comment that one of the things the left doesn't understand is that you can't put a gun rack in a bowl. I'm not anti-bowl. I'm not anti any particular choice you make. You should be allowed to drive what you want to drive. But I first got onto this when Obama went to campaign for the Democratic candidate for the Senate, for Teddy Kennedy's seat in the special election. And he did this entire riff on Scott Brown's truck. Scott Brown was campaigning around the state in a pickup. And you could tell, if you go back and read the speech that Obama gave in Boston just before the election, you could tell that he was fixated on this pickup truck and how inappropriate it was to have a pickup. I actually used Prius back then because the Volt didn't exist. I said at the time, Obama doesn't realize you can't put a gun around a pig in a Prius. And you could just tell that this was the Harvard academician at work. And he's going, why do you need a pickup truck? You could be bicycling to the campus. I don't understand. So you may think I'm making this up. Here is the president in 2011 in Pennsylvania. I know some of these big guys. They're all still driving their big SUVs. You know, they got their big monster trucks and everything. And that, there's a certain weirdness to this whole notion. I mean, this is the guy who flew in on Air Force One. You think at some level he'd be secure. He'd be okay. People are allowed to have an SUV. And he goes around in entire fleets of SUVs. You ever watch the presidential motorcade? 19 SUVs ride around so he can tell you you shouldn't have one because the Secret Service needs it. Some guy had an emotion and Obama goes, you're one of them? Well, now, here's my point. If you're complaining about the price of gas and you're only getting 8 miles a gallon, laughter, you may have a big family, but it's probably not that big. How many do you have? 10 kids, you say. Guy starts playing with 10 kids. Hard to get in the boat. Ten kids. Well, you definitely need a hybrid. Now, this is my point, which I think our friends on the left don't get. We are for freedom. We don't think politicians should dictate to the American people the size of the background inside the administration. Thank Speaker John Boehner who put this out. It's really helpful. He took the speech in late Friday afternoon. They put out a step-by-step example. February 4th, 2009. Just months after President Obama's anti-energy secretary said, quote, somehow we have to figure out how to boost the price of gasoline to the levels in Europe. I want you to remember this. Obama picks somebody to be Secretary of Energy who believes that the natural price of gasoline should be European, which is $9 or $10 a gallon. So when they tell you, oh, this is all a massive baloney, this is a deliberate strategy of the left to punish the American people in the driving of the vehicles they want. In February 2009, barely in office, the Obama administration began scrapping leases for oil shale development and canceled 77 leases for oil and gas production in Utah. Gasoline at that point was $1.91 a gallon. In March 2009, ABC News says the White House is closely monitoring the expedited cylinder loan project, even as it was delaying new American energy production that would help make us less dependent on foreign energy. Gasoline at that point was $1.91. Remember, Cylindra was the last time Obama had an answer to why we didn't need to have any fossil fuels, because rather than have the oil companies have a tax break, he wanted the money so he could give it out to his friends so they could run companies that would go bankrupt. Gas at that point was $1.94 a gallon. The Obama administration in January 2010 announces new bureaucratic hurdles to American energy production that Secretary of Interior Salazar admitted, quote, could add delays in the leasing and drilling process. Gas at that point was $2.67 a gallon. March 2010. Instead of opening new areas to energy exploration and development, President Obama locks deep ocean energy production on 60% of America's outer continental shelf. I want you to remember this, because in his speech, he explicitly is dishonest about this. President Obama blocks deep ocean energy production on 60% of America's outer continental shelf. Gas was $2.87 a gallon. December 1st, 2010, the president reimposes and expands the moratorium on offshore energy production. Gas was $2.86 a gallon. On November 2011, the Obama administration releases a plan for a five-year moratorium on offshore energy production, placing, quote, some of the most promising energy resources in the world off limits. According to the House Natural Resources Committee, gas was $3.42 a gallon. January 18th, 2012, President Obama rejects the bipartisan Keystone XL pipeline, and thus kills more than 20,000 jobs. Gas was at that point $3.39 a gallon. Now, I just give you all that back before the speech. And of course, what happened was his advisors came to him and said, "It's already priced, the gas is rising before we even get to summer when it goes up even more. You better find a way to be pro-gasoline instead of anti-gasoline." And so, despite this entire background, he decided to go. And he basically gave a speech in Miami, which could be summarized, quote, "Why I didn't mean to do everything I did." Remember, this administration was ran in 2008 on yes we can, and is going to run in 2012 on why we couldn't. Now, there are parts of this speech I agree with. Is wonderful, even if said by him, it's a little bit funny. He says, quote, "We don't have the luxury of pretending. We got to look at the facts, look at the science, figure out what we need to do." Well, as a historian, Mr. President, I take up your challenge. So in the next few minutes, I'm going to take your speech, and we're going to look at the facts. He goes on to say that, quote, I want you to think about this in context. Everything else he's going to say later. Quote, "We do have in this country limitless sources of energy." Well, if he believes that, why doesn't he unleash the American people to develop the limitless sources of energy that he claims to be? He says, and I think this tells you why he's in this. Somebody in his political shop came to him and said, he has the following quote: "When gas prices go up, it hurts everybody." It's true. Gasoline prices affect, and diesel prices affect the truck that delivers the groceries, they affect the cost of agriculture, they affect the cost of manufacturing, they affect the cost of driving to work, they affect the cost of grandparents coming to see their grandchildren, every way you turn around. But Mr. President, if you understand, so when gas prices go up and hurts everybody, why have you not fired Chu, who is specifically dedicated to raising the price of gasoline at European levels? Yeah. And he turned against it. He says, quote, "High gas prices are like a tax straight out of your paycheck." So you could think of gasoline prices when you go to pull up your car as the Obama tax. This is the new Obama tax straight out of your pocket. You're just quoting the president's own words. He cites letters. He says he gets letters every day, and they pull out some for him to read, and last night he happened to read some. Two of them said, quote, "I'm not sure I'm going to be able to keep my job if gas prices keep going up so high." Now, first of all, that's probably true, and there are probably people who write that. I ran into a lady in Las Vegas who lives in rural Nevada, and she said she's now living to two trips a week because the price of gas and bikes hit her if everybody was in need. But as I read that and reread it, something occurred to me. He didn't have to be quoting somebody else. Let me read this sentence as though Obama had said it about himself. Quote, "I'm not sure I'm going to be able to keep my job with gas prices." Step two is to drill, and then step three is to keep drilling. This is a great place for small history lessons in Renton. He says, we hear the same thing every year. We've heard the same thing for 30 years. He goes on to say a little later, quote, you know we can't just drill our way to lower gas prices. Well, let me give the president a brief history lesson. In 1976, gasoline averaged $2.46 a gallon. By 1980, with Jimmy Carter's fairly idiotic policies, it had gotten to $3.33 a gallon. You will remember Jimmy Carter had gas rationing. How many of you remember you bought gasoline every other day, you paid somebody a friend? Sort of the ultimate government intervention, right? A good friend of mine, Dave Boxing of Citizens United, was 13 that year. And everybody remembers it vividly because every morning his father set him out back with a screwdriver. And his job was to change the license plate so that the car could be gasoline. It's a great test for liberals and conservatives. Ask your friends and neighbors back home. If the government adopts a policy so stupid 13-year-olds are being taught how to cheat, a conservative says, we should drop the policy. A liberal says, this is proof that we need license plate police at every gas station. So, gasoline prices have gone up, despite rationing, from $2.46 to $3.33. The first executive order Ronald Reagan signed deregulated gasoline. The left was panic-stricken. The New York Times thought prices would skyrocket. And then 6 months, they collapsed. In fact, the collapse of oil prices was a major factor in defeating the Soviet Empire because it stripped them of their hard currency. By 1988, remember it's 333 when Reagan sworn in. By 1988, it has dropped to $1.72. Now, Mr. President, I know but this math is kind of tricky because there aren't nine zeros behind it. But if you started at 333 and after 8 years of drilling, you're at $1.72, that pretty well proves that markets work and that enough incentives will, in fact, lead people to produce enough energy to, in fact, bring down the price. Now, quote, we need to sustain all of the above strategy that develops every available source of our energy, yes, oil and gas, but also wind and solar and nuclear and biofuels and more. Well, this is exactly what John Boehner has been campaigning on for 4 years. I hope the House Republicans in the near future will move an all of the above energy bill and allow the president to support them. So I try to get Democratic votes for an all of the above energy bill. And we'll see whether or not he meant this, which, by the way, he didn't. But it's a great line, and it's exactly the Republican policy. It's nice to think that in a moment of panic, that Barack Obama would briefly, for a moment, sound like he was a Republican and a conservative. But I just want to point out, he literally was citing what John Boehner's been for. Now, he says, and I think this is very important, because if you listen to him, he's totally confused. He says, quote, we're not going to transition out of oil anytime soon. Well, that's true. Which would imply that if you wanted to bring prices down, you'd probably need oil. He goes on to say, America is producing more oil today than at any time in the last 8 years. It's true, because North Dakota, in private land, despite the Obama administration, is developing. Now, in fact, on federal land, production is down 11%. So in the area he controls, production's down. In the area that's that horrid free enterprise stuff where people get rich, production is up. So he's now claiming credit for the area he can't control in order to have us think he's actually for what he imposes. Let me give you an example of the depth of mendacity of this administration. He says, quote, over the last 3 years, my administration has approved dozens of new pipelines, including from Canada. Now, Mr. President, you know how limited your respect for the intelligence of the American people must be. How could you possibly veto the only major pipeline that matters in Canada, the Keystone Pipeline, and turn around and suggest to us that the fact that we've approved dozens of tiny boats, this would be like saying, my Navy has 11 new ships, they're all rowboats. I mean, how do you deal with a president who's this fundamentally out of touch with being honest? I mean, it would be one thing to come and say, yes, I vetoed the Keystone Pipeline, and here's why. But to come and say, well, I've approved lots of pipelines. Why are you mad at me? Well, because you didn't approve the one that mattered. Keystone Pipeline is worth 700,000 barrels of oil a day going to Houston. That's how big a deal it is. Keystone Pipeline ties the U.S. and Canada together. This president is driving Canada into a partnership with China in order to build the pipeline due west in Canada to deliver the oil at Vancouver. It is a strategic disaster of the first order, and I commit to you, the very first day I'm president, immediately after the inaugural address, I will sign an executive order which authorizes construction as of that day. We plan to make available more than 75% of our potential offshore oil and gas resources. Sounds good. This is when you know he's a lawyer. He has carefully selected out a phrase which is totally misleading but technically not inaccurate. Because what he'll tell you is that he's talking about the area that they can't remember. This is the guy who wanted to abolish the inventory of assets. He's now telling you in the areas we currently know about, that they want to make 75% available. What he didn't tell you is, under this definition, 85% of the offshore acreage is not available. In other words, all the areas we don't know about, we're not going to know about, because he won't make them available. Therefore, he can say to you, I'm doing the stuff that we know about, it's not his fault we don't know about it, except he won't let us find out. Now, my view is very different. I think each state has to make its own decision. I would allow the states to have 50% of the royalties, which means that Sacramento would start thinking seriously about development. But I will tell you, for example, Senator Webb and Senator Warner, Democrats, have a very good bill in for Virginia to develop offshore. And I think you'd find that if we opened up offshore, it would be amazing how fast things would be developed. Now, the president goes on to say that, and here I agree with him, but he doesn't get the meaning. Quote, the single biggest thing that's causing the price of oil to spike right now is instability in the Middle East, this time around Iran. I agree with him. The only other example, one more example of how fundamentally dishonest this president is. He says, quote, we only have 2% of the world's oil reserves. Now what he's referring to is proven current reserves. But let me give you some numbers. Go back to being a historian for a minute. In 1980, we had 30 billion barrels of proven oil reserve. Since 1980, we have pumped 75 billion barrels. And I'm walking you through this, and I know this is a fairly lengthy speech, but I think it's in the Reagan tradition of facts. Because I want to start demolishing Obama as a person who systematically misleads the American people and who systematically lives in the world. Was 30 billion barrels. Since then, because of advancing technology, because of changing prices, because of entrepreneurship, we've produced 75 billion barrels out of a 30 billion barrel reserve, and we have more reserves today than we had in 1980. So if you were being honest, Mr. President, what you would say is the lesson in North Dakota is we have huge volumes. In fact, the technical estimate is that we have 1.4 trillion barrels of potentially recoverable reserves in the United States, depending on technology. That's 1,400,000,000,000 barrels when in 1980 we thought the total reserve was 30 billion. That's the difference. The reason I tell people I'm cheerful, I'm a technological optimist. I actually think the Wright brothers work every time I get an airplane. But I also believe we can find new and better ways to get natural gas. We We went from a 7-year supply to a 125-year supply because of science and technology. The fact is we've gone to a dramatically increased supply of oil because of science and technology. So I'm an optimist. Now, the president then goes on to say, quote, we're taking every possible action to develop safely a near 100-year supply of natural gas in this country. That is fundamentally misleading. They have a task force of, I think, 8 different agencies trying to figure out how to block fracking, which is the method by which we get natural gas. They are methodically trying to undermine and cripple the natural gas industry. And it is stunningly dishonest for this president to pretend that he favors something that his administration is actively working to undermine and cripple. And I think we should be holding them accountable. Correct point that there'll probably be 600,000 new jobs in natural gas by the end of the decade. My only point is terrific. Why don't we try to get all over the next 2 years so we put Americans to work now rather than waiting for the next president? I mean, he said to me as he was. It's a very confused speech. You can't figure out is he for energy and jobs or is he against energy and jobs? And he keeps saying. He also lives in this fantasy world where government says, quote, talking about fracking and how we get natural gas out of shale. It says, quote, it was public dollars, public research dollars, that over the years helped develop the technologies that companies are right now using to extract all this natural gas. Now, it's true there was in the 60s a Department of Energy study of whether or not you could use nuclear explosions at depth. It's also true that there were some projects done in the 70s. However, just to set the record as a historian, fracking begins in Kansas in 1947. It expands to Oklahoma in 1949. It's done in Canada in the 1950s. And George Mitchell of the private sector is regarded as the pioneer to develop fracking. This would be like suggesting that the Air Force invented the airplane and they don't know who these two Wright brothers are because after all, they were private sector guys who were just bicycle mechanics, but they have invented the airplane when actually it must have been the Air Force because everything that's good is done by the government. This is the Obama mindset. Now, the last one he gets into is almost as good as, well, I don't know, it's either almost as good or better than inflating your tires. He explains that up to 17% of the oil we import for transportation could be algae. Now, I'm a scientific optimist. I have a friend in Texas A&M who is developing algae that eats municipal waste and then produces alcohol as a byproduct, and at some point down the road, it will probably be useful. But this is like cylinder. The president is for any fantasy that doesn't work today, as opposed to any practical thing that works today, so as to take your money to prop up something which might well work. You know, cylinder might work in 30 years. Cylinder might even work in 10 years. But it won't work if it's being given venture capital by the Department of Energy. Similarly, I'm all for investing. You say to me, do I want to do research on algae? Absolutely. Would I be willing to look at pilot projects in algae? Absolutely. I think that probably if you did all the algae development you could, by the end of this decade, you could probably actually be fueling, you know, 12 airplanes, 20 airplanes, 30 airplanes. But what are the odds that you're going to ramp up at a commercial price gasoline from algae in the foreseeable future? Not very good. Now, most of us live in the foreseeable future. What is the odds that if you actually allow people to drill, and if you allow people to build refineries, you can get dramatically less expensive gasoline in the foreseeable future? Really, really high. So what you have here, and this is why I wanted to take this time to do this, this is a very revealing speech. You have an intellectual left-winger who lives in a fantasy world, in which he very cleverly uses language to say things that aren't true and sound good. Because he knows if he tells you what he really wants to do, you will defeat him in the landscape. One of our jobs, of course, is to make sure the American people understand what he really wants to do. The last point I want to make about what he said was, he says 3 or 4 times, there are no silver bullets. There is a pet. Big difference. A presidential 10 could today sign approval of Keystone Pipeline. That's 700,000 barrels. Presidential pen could today sign approval to go back to the Gulf of Mexico. That's about 400,000 barrels a day. Presidential pen could today approved areas of Alaska that we know don't work. That's about $1,200,000. In three signatures, we have 2.3 million barrels a day of additional energy in the United States. Three signatures. So I would say we're not looking for silver bullets. We're looking for presidential leadership. Our choice is between energy independence and never again bowing to a Saudi king and $2.50 a gallon of gasoline and about $16 trillion in royalties over the next generation. Enough, you could literally pay off the national debt just with the royalties from the federal government and the government with no tax increase, and at least 1 million new jobs. That's our side. His side is a series of fantasies in which your tax money is thrown away on products that are not commercially feasible, while you pay higher and higher and higher prices and are coerced into smaller and smaller and smaller businesses. These are the two futures we're going to campaign on this year. I would ask you to help us. We need your help. If you're on Twitter, you can go to #250gas. Those of you who want to support me and help me, you go to Facebook or you go on email. I hope you'll put down just three quick things. Newt equals $2.50 a gallon. Finally, we're launching a project at Newt.org asking people to give 1 Newt gallon to the campaign. That's $2.50. We already have 170,000 donors, and we thought this was the right price to drive home. I believe $2.50 a gallon versus $10 a gallon is a major theme from now the election, and if jobs and paychecks versus food stamps and dependency is a theme, I believe we could win an historic election. Cliff and I are thrilled to be here. We do need your help. I do think this is the most important election of your lifetime. And very briefly, allow me to outline this fairly complex, but I think really important case about how far wrong Barack Obama was on Friday and how much right we together are about America's future. Thank you very much.